Hello everyone, we are live yet again. This is one of my author's chats of the week, and I know it takes a moment for this app to kind of notify people, so we'll be here waiting. But I'll keep also my eye open for my co-host, and then we'll get going shortly. But this has been a... I feel like, well, I purposely planned for January to be an extremely busy month, and so far that has been proven true, but that's okay. The idea was to upfront all the big stuff, and then so the rest of the year theoretically would get easier going forward. I've been working with a lot of different projects, setting up fun things like future Kickstarters and different book releases. I have two next month and things like that. So it's been very busy, which is great. But I'll be happy when I can like take a little bit of a breath regardless. Anywho, I hope everyone's week is going well as the beginning of your year. I'm excited about some of the new reveals that I'll be doing over the next few weeks for myself, including I've been working with one of my cover designers, so hopefully before too long I will have a cover reveal for the fourth book of my young adult portal fantasy. It's an adventure style epic fantasy, full of quests and multiple realities and magical worlds and fun stuff like that. So the fourth book will be coming out later on this spring, and that's the one I'm setting up a Kickstarter for. And the cool thing about that one is it's kind of has some underlying themes of like this magical gladiatorial style combat arena, and I absolutely love this, and so I'm really excited about that book. But we'll be like I said, I've been working with the cover designer to try to capture that as well as make sure it meshes with the prior three books, because even though the original design that came back was gorgeous, it really was gorgeous, it wasn't exactly fitting with the other books of the series, so I'm hoping that will change going forward. So we shall see. But yeah, so that's what's been going on with me, and consistently I've been pretty good about writing almost a chapter a day for the project I've been working on. Now, there are slightly smaller chapters in some of my other full-length books, and that's one of the reasons why I can say I've been writing a full chapter a day. But it's also nice because I finally got to the part of that particular project where I get to write a battle scene, and I love action, I love battles, and this one had some aerial combat, which was a lot of fun, and so I've been really excited to finally get to that part of the story, which I always think is, you know, highly entertaining. But yeah, for you, if you like fantasy, what are some kind of books that you enjoy? What are some of the things that you absolutely love? Because I'm always looking for new things to read. Of course, I am also glancing over at my gigantic TBR, physical TBR. It keeps growing, and I need to work on like knocking that down. I've been actually reading a fellow book talker's works, and that's Z.S. Diamante. Oh my god. But yeah, Zach's work I've been going through, and he's a friend of mine, and it's been kind of fun reading his book, which is an epic fantasy dealing with griffins, wyverns, orcs, and it has a big feel for the D&D community, but it's been a lot of fun too. So excited about finishing that book and keeping my eye out for my co-host, hoping he'll jump on. I know he was just live a moment ago, but I don't know if this is one of his first joint lives, so we shall see. There's always a little bit of a glitch initially, and we'll figure that one out. But yeah, as for other things I've been doing, I have, for the holidays, received, I guess, a photo box. I don't really know what the term is, a light box, photo box, with the idea that when I work on photographing, hi, how are you? Physical copies, they don't have as much shine and they look really good, so I'm hoping to get that up and running so I can kind of update my photos on my own bookshops, because now that I'm selling direct, I want them to look as professional as possible, and photography is not my skill. But how are you? How are you doing? I love always chatting and catching up with fellow authors. And talking about fellow authors, I'm working on signing up for some author, kind of fun author events for this year. So if you participate to anything from cons or conventions or of learning about more, that's kind of the thing I'm doing is trying to sign up and get my schedule going. A little behind. Hello. Can you hear me?
Hello. Oh, is my camera not on?
I do not see you, and I'm going to turn up my volume. And I know this almost always happens where someone jumps on and it takes a moment to get the visual going. But I hear you.
There we go.
Sorry, turned up my volume. So I still see your icon, but there we go. Now I got you. Hello.
Hey.
How are you doing?
I am doing really good. I'm also really tired, though. I taught like 3 workshops this week.
Oh, see, you're one of those authors that is constantly doing so much. And I, right before you jumped on live, I was just briefly mentioning that I'm starting to get to the point where I need to schedule any events. If I'm going to do any this year, it's time for me to like schedule them. And you're always good about that. You always do like everything up and down the East Coast, it feels like.
East Coast, West Coast. I've been doing a bunch of workshops out here in Colorado. Ooh. So, yeah.
That's so much fun!
We had like a little prompt-a-palooza last night. It was really fun. So Everybody put a prompt in the chat, and then we all just wrote for 10 minutes and then talked about it and shared what we wrote and then put another prompt in and did it again, and it was so much fun.
I love that idea. I do. I feel like when someone like challenges you to think outside of your, you know, what you expect, it can kind of stir some creativity that you didn't know you had or didn't expect. So I absolutely love that kind of idea. Yeah. And hi, Stephanie, as people are chiming in and joining, what I usually do is just to give you a heads up, like it's pretty much casual, we're going to chit chat. But if you ever see any questions or comments popping up, you feel free to make note of them, answer them. I will, if this platform allows me, we will always see sometimes the glitches. We'll repurpose this on YouTube and put all your tags below, so they won't be able to see the comments, so that's why I always like kind of shine light on those if they're bookish related.
That's super fair.
But yeah, so thank you again for joining me this evening or afternoon or wherever you are in the world. And for you, I'll let you kick off with what you write, a little bit about you, however you pitch yourself, and we'll go from there. Because I feel like everybody knows my stuff at this point.
I'm like, I knew this was going to happen. I put the book up there. Yeah, I'll go ahead and get started with that. Hey, everybody who doesn't know me, I'm October K. Santarelli, and I'm primarily a fantasy author. I live out here in Denver, Colorado, and my debut novel, City of Day, came out this year in February 2023. It is no longer 2023.
No, it's not.
And City of Day also just won a little award for cover of the year from Go Indie Now. So I'm very excited about that.
I love it. Yes, I absolutely actually really do love your cover. It's so detailed because you look at it and it's like a world within a world, and it goes so deep and the rich in depth in the little orb. Yes.
And there's like the closer you get, the wilder it gets. There are birds the size of, like, they're smaller than a hair. They're teeny tiny. I don't know how he got them in there.
That's fantastic.
Just like, they're so little.
I love that. I absolutely love that. No, yeah, I've been working with a cover designer to kind of work on my next book, big book cover for my young adult portal fantasy series. And it's always fun to kind of do that process. Now, with you, how was your experience? Did you have a lot of say? How did that kind of go?
We kind of had a really interesting cover experience. This is actually my book's second cover. The first cover is this one, which is nowhere near as good.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Still very intriguing, though.
Yeah. Still, like, it's not bad, but it was not what we asked for. Mm-hmm. My poor publisher got COVID literally right before my launch and wasn't able to follow up with the cover artist. Mm-hmm. So we got this cover handed to us 3 days before my book was set to release. So we had no choice, and we immediately started working on the next cover.
I understand.
Yeah. And so with that next cover, my publisher and I had a little talk and I was like, look, let me handle it. let me handle it. Give me a budget. Let me handle it. And he was like, okay. And he gave me the budget. I went and found the artist. I gave him all the references and we worked together on it really closely. Joe's is fantastic at being really communicative and like the back and forth with him is great. The more references you give him, the happier he is. So I was like, here's 72 pictures. And he was like, yes. And then after we finished the art, I took it to my typographer, Amphi, who is here on TikTok. That's what we're on. Amphi is on here on TikTok, and Amphi is an amazing typographer and did all of the text. There's like this, the font has like shadows to it so that it matches the light from the orb. And on the back, she put all the quotes, and on the inside flaps, there's another little tagline that has the fade. And yeah,
you know,
Amphi is fantastic.
Right, you're like, ooh, that's a pretty book.
I love it. I love my book cover. And yeah, I did have a lot of say and I did have a lot of work with them. And then I basically gave it to my publisher and was like, you like it? And he was like, yeah. And that was the end of it. We put it on the book.
That's great. Yeah. And for anybody who's jumping on, who's on the writing author side of things. Now I'm indie, so I am my own everything, it feels like, except the editor. I definitely pay an editor and a cover designer, but it does feel like there's so much that I have to be paying attention to. So for you, with you work with a publisher, how does that kind of work with you? Like, how did you find each other? How is that process?
So I'm with Falstaff Books, which is a small press. It's still like indie press level-ish. And I found him at Dragon Con in Georgia. In the bar.
Where we all meet every evening.
Where everybody meets. If you want to find the writers at Dragon Con, you go to the bar at the Westin. And I was introduced to him. Eventually, we started talking several drinks in. And I was like, here's the book I'm working on. And he was like, can you send that to me? And I did. And he bought it. He bought the whole trilogy on the spot. So I like working with him in the sense that I don't have to find an editor. I had three separate editors on City of Day. The first one was my publisher, who is the head of the company. Like, so I was like, oh, that's special for my dev edits. And then Paul for my copy edits. And I cannot remember my line edits. I'm sorry. But I'm sorry out there, wherever you are, line editor.
There's so many names to, like, pay attention to. It's fine.
Yeah. So, yeah, for that one, I didn't have to find editors. I did have to find my cover artist, but not the first time. that was more like, oh, let's try that again. I had to find a cover artist. But, yeah, for the most part. The name of the company, Stephen asked, what was the name of the company? It's Falstaff Books. F-A-L-S-T-A-F-F. The Misfit Toys of Publishing is the little tagline. So we're the weird books.
I feel like that's all I write is weird books. No, again, it's fun to like find other people who like books that aren't expected, because there are so many people who, and that's totally fine. Readers can enjoy whatever you want, first and foremost, but there are definitely the writers who write certain formulaic styles and people love them. And then there are other people who kind of are like a little more edgy, the indie of the indie.
I wrote a book that's weird about murder ghosts, and I did send it to bigger houses as well. I actually did have, I entered into negotiations with a big house on this. However, they were like, we want you to change the ending, and then we want you to change the ending of the whole series. And I was like, no. And ended up choosing the smaller publisher so that I could have the story out the way I want it.
And that's something to definitely be aware of, is if anybody goes through the querying process, understand, or trying to decide between indie, small print, mid-size, big, the bigger you go, the less control you as an author generally have. So expect changes, some that you may like and some you may not. And yes, there are perks, and there are also downsides of all of it. So.
Yeah, the reason they wanted me to change the ending of book one is because it is a cliffhanger. I do end on a cliffhanger, a very mean cliffhanger. Like, I was like, I don't like my readers. I'm gonna make them mad, and then ended the book. but they wanted it to be able to stand alone, which is something that trad houses really like, is a standalone with series potential, is what they call it. Especially on a new author or an untested in their field author. They want a book that they can sell one of, not a trilogy. They don't want to commit to three books at once. And if that one book does well, you can get another contract. Yeah.
I know that's like pretty standard from what I've heard from authors who have queried and, gone trad or queried and decided not to. That's usually the way it goes. And for me, being as much of a control freak as I am, that would be very hard. It's a nice idea. And maybe one day I would have the right book and decide to go through that traditional route, but or try to go through the traditional route. But I don't know. I also like controlling and having my edgy endings and having my
Yeah, and you got so many out too. Like, traditional takes forever to get things out.
Yes.
My publisher has had book two of my series for over a year, and it's coming out this April. Like, it
Wow.
takes about a year to a year and a half.
But now, for you, are you working on books behind the scenes? Because I would feel like, I know for me, I'm constantly writing. I've have way too many projects in different stages at this point. It's crazy. But I'm assuming it's the same for you, where you're not waiting around.
No, I actually have an indie published omnibus of novellas that I'm publishing this April as well. I came up with my release date before my publisher told me my release date, so they're the same time. It's fine.
Release. I love that.
yeah, so I'm working on an omnibus of novellas that follow one character, and they're a prequel to another book that I've been working on. I am doing rewrites on a transgender retelling of Cinderella. I am outlining a dragon book. I was like, all right, I finally want to write a dragon book. It took a while, but here we are. I'm outlining another book that is, I have joke books that turn out to be really good ideas eventually. And this one was like one of those Facebook memes where it's like, you're going to be Lord your pet's name, the last thing you ate of the last place you shopped. And I ended up being Lord Mogwai Vanilla Pecan of the Quirky Cup Society. And I was like, that's actually like, that's a book title. I'm maybe not with Mogwai's name in it. I might change that one, but the rest of it would make a really cool book. So I'm working on outlining that one as well.
Now, based on that title, it almost sounds like a cozy, but what kind of book is it going to be?
I'm hoping that it is kind of like a portal cozy, magic portal cozy. You know, the teacups are going to be magic.
I love that.
I was like, that sounds really cute. But yeah, I think it is going to lean closer to cozy than I have leaned before, because usually I write really dark stories. So.
I love cozy too. You sell me at fantasy. If you say fantasy, I'm like, yes, okay, let's go.
Oh, and I almost forgot about the 12 book series that I started writing book one of for November in Nano.
See, it's hard to like, okay, it really is. It's hard to like just, I don't know. It wows me when an author will sit down and write one series and then move to the next. I'm always like, ooh, pretty shiny idea. Must figure out how to fit that into the middle of all the other things.
Yeah, I just go crazy and don't stop writing. I've already written over 30,000 words this year.
Wow. I'm a little behind, but I also was traveling in the first few days and was sick.
Oh no, are you feeling better?
Make all these excuses, but the sicknesses and all that was actually real. But yeah, I'm a little behind you, but no, it's that's a good start to your year. I love that.
Thank you.
It's really good. And going back to your potential cozy portal fantasy, because you did have that most fantastic book box, I can just see the next one with that for that book. Deal with again some really cute teas and again make it like nice and charming and
There's this shop on Etsy that has mismatched teacups for sale that you can buy in bulk. And I want to buy a set of them for the next book box. I'm like, it's going to be amazing.
Okay. I always support Etsy 100%, but also check any antique shops or anything like that, or even flea markets, because you never know what kind of teacups and stuff they will be selling for, or the little dishes or and everything.
Very little.
Because publishing is not the cheapest of trades.
No, not at all. I'm sitting there and I'm like, I'm in the green this year. It's only been a week, so I'm going to hold on to this as long as I can. I'm in the green right now. That's why we have other jobs as well, most of the time. I'm not yet lucky enough where I can make my writing do everything for me.
Well, yeah, I kind of cobble together with writing and painting people's pets. So very different things, but they're both very artistic, so.
I do sensitivity reading. So I'm still in the publishing industry, and I've actually been a sensitivity reader longer than I've been published. And I read other people's books for queer content and invisible chronic illness content, and then give them feedback, and it's really fun.
Which is good, because I was going to talk to you behind the scenes about a project that the one I'm writing on right now that I'm not going to mention too much about publicly until it's written and done, but I was already kind of like putting you on the back burner of, I need a tap October's shoulder and be lucky.
Yeah, let's talk later. It'll be great. I'm excited.
I love it. So for you, okay, so you have already a double release in April, and all these other projects, are there any other releases this year, or are you just going to focus on April and continue to kind of move things along accordingly for the rest of the year?
I'm not sure if book three will be coming out before the end of 2024, but I am working on, I'm part of a writer's group for a featured webtoon that should be coming out at the end of 2024. And we skipped right to featured, which is going to be really cool. And I'm just waiting on a little bit, like, it's really slow to get contracts moving. And that's where we're at with it. We're like, we have a lot written, and then we're like, and now we can't do anything else right now.
I get that. Yeah, one of the things that I'm a little behind already this year, because with everything, December always is never what I expect, I feel like, which means January is not exactly what I always hope for. But one of the things that I'm aiming to do, at least by February, is start doing signups for my next Kickstarter campaign that I've been working, scrambling around, trying to make sure everything looks nice and fun like that. So that's one of my big projects, non-directly publishing related, but will be publishing related projects.
I like how you have all these different categories. I want to see the list of just the different categories. This is related to publishing. This one will be related to publishing, but isn't right now. This one is.
I mean, it's kind of true. It's not a direct publishing, but it's part of it in a weird roundabout way. But that's always kind of fun for you. Okay, so for you, when you were doing the book box, and this is one of the things, is I haven't done a fancy book box like you, but what I have done is Kickstarter last year, and because I had all the things for Kickstarter, I ended up with a book box. So for you, how was your thought processes of putting everything together for your first book? Because again, you had your cute tea, and you had your little strainer, and these beautiful, you know, artworks and everything. I'm looking at it right there.
Yeah, I went and trawled a dozen different bulk sites. And was like, I could use this for one box for a book. I could use that for a different one. And I was just, you know, I window shop a lot. I have way too many Amazon lists that will never actually have anything purchased off of them, because I just like to collect things. But I happened to collect enough stuff to put together the book box, and a friend who helped me with the customization on the leather bookmarks, which are my favorite part of the box. I was so upset that I only had just enough to give to people. I was like, I want one. And it's Natalia Hernandez, who is also here on TikTok, is the one who did the customization on my bookmarks for me.
Ooh, fantastic.
But I mostly just spent several months, you know, I was waiting for the new cover, and I was getting antsy. And I was like, I have to do something, but I wasn't actively marketing the bad cover or the old cover, not the bad cover, the other one.
I have a story for you, that kind of thing. Yes, I do.
And so since I wasn't marketing anything, I was like, okay, well, when the cover changes, what am I doing with my life? And I put together the book box to try and get it out there, re-announced all of the fun stuff.
It is fantastic. I'm just feel so like proud and like complimented that I was picked. Thank you.
Yeah.
But yeah, with that said, reminding me about like original covers, and that's how that happened to my first one. And it was a little different because, again, being indie, I technically had control of it, but I wanted what I wanted, which can be great for some things, but you have to be aware of your market, which is your other thing. So I wanted what I wanted and had a cover that originally I thought was like really cool and everything, but between having no clue how to market myself, and then finally, when I started figuring things out, realizing that that book cover wasn't right, I finally had to make that decision, be like, I need to scratch this and start over. But and that's how I
So
ended up with
hard.
Never Seen in the Dark, but like the pretty blue cover over there. So I was just like, at least it's a little more new adult, edgier for my dark shifter fantasy. But I also had to learn certain ages, you can't do things like can't show blood on certain ages, but you can for others if you so choose and stuff like that. And maybe it was a little too.
She does that. You have people ripped apart on the cover. That's what I'm picturing. That was your original.
Not that bad, but it looks very different. And it is one of those things as going through the writing process and getting to those stages where the first time you have major edits you have to do, and you have to like grr, and you're like, no, it's perfect the way it is. Don't ever do it. But when you finally make some of those changes, you're like, okay, maybe it was for the better. Same thing for the cover design. It was like, no, it's my baby. And then looking back, I was like, oh, but it's better now.
I'm just so glad that that editing process gets easier the more you do
Oh,
it. Like
very.
now I get edits back, I get 8 pages of dev edits back, and I'm like, all right, let's do it. Like
It's not exactly what I want, but I'm okay. I'm okay.
and I did learn something really valuable from one of my mentors, and that was any editing that happens with your book is a conversation.
That's
So whenever I was like, I actually really want to push back on this point because I feel like this point is important to the story. The editor would work with me to improve that instead of cutting it out.
Fair.
Yeah, so I did like that.
Yes. And that is also to be aware of, and again, everybody's different and everybody's relationships with editors can be different, but like going through that process of knowing that sometimes they don't know what's coming down the road. Like if you're trying to insert something that may not really matter in this book, but it does apply or will matter in a later book. It's those are the things that you're definitely like, don't touch it yet.
No,
There's
not that one.
let's
Leave
stop.
it. Oh, my
There's a
dog just looked at me like, what? I'm not doing anything. Sorry, buddy.
Okay, actually, so for you, I mean, I got the notification that I know panels are getting ready and certain people are signing up for panels and getting gearing up for that. So are you doing that this year? Presumably you are, because I was so happy to be on one of your panels this past fall.
Yeah, I am most likely going to still be doing panels at Dragon Con in Georgia. I have been invited to be a guest at Jordan Con in Atlanta, Georgia, and that's happening in April, and that's when I'm releasing all the stuff, so it's going to be a wild weekend for me. and then I'm also going to be a guest at well, I'm hoping, I haven't gotten the news back yet, but I applied to be a guest at Multiverse Atlanta, which is the coolest little conference I've ever been to, so.
Okay. I wish I knew when those signups were, because I didn't hear about it
It's still
until
open.
last. Huh?
It's still open for multiverse. They're open.
Wait, hold on. I always keep a notepad because I learn things. No, it was on a memo, but then I was like, maybe it's too late because I'm like, again, it's already the new year, and I was like, should I have already been signed up for these?
Some of them, the windows are harder to get into. Like, you can apply for Dragon Con and Multiverse now, but Jordan Con's closed right before Christmas because they're earlier in the year, so they need the time. But Jordan Con is also a really cool conference because it started as a literary con for Robert Jordan's Wheel of Time. That's why it's called Jordan
Okay.
Con.
Yeah.
And so it's all book nerds, and they're all fantasy book nerds, and it's grown to be about more than just Robert Jordan, but it's so refreshing that they have this giant sweeping author's alley, and that's the focus for shopping for the conference. And
It.
yeah, I like
That's
Jordan Con a
so
lot.
cool. No, I have not. Okay. It's so funny because I moved back to Georgia a couple 2.5 years ago, and even though I live outside Atlanta, so I miss a lot of these memos until someone else is like, "Yeah, did you not know there was a thing?" I was like, "No, I did not." Where
Whoops.
do people find out this? You know, I have to be better about like keeping my ear to the grapevine or whatever you want to say.
Lot of what I do is I look out for where all of my author friends are like, I'll be at this conference this weekend, and I'm like, make a note of that, apply to that one later. Like, that's how I've built my list up, and my publisher goes to a lot of conferences, so I take note of those conferences as
Of course,
well.
that makes sense. I love that. Resources. Love resources,
And
love
then I don't need to get a table.
Yeah, because like last year was the first time I did the what is now going to be Authors Nation, which was the 20 Books to 50K conference, and that was a lot of fun. Now again, I was attending just to learn and be wowed, but that was so much fun. And I just got the notification. They're like, registration's open again. And I was like, ooh, can I afford it again? I'm like, maybe.
I think me and a couple of my author friends are trying to figure out if we're gonna go. Like, we're looking at logistics right now. I can drive there. I live close enough, but everybody else might have to fly. I will probably still fly. Let's not kid ourselves. I'm too lazy to drive for 9 hours. But yeah, no, like, we're looking into going. I haven't actually been, but a lot of the people who are there I've taught with at other writing conferences. Mal Cooper and I have taught together
Oh,
and
yeah,
worked
I think we
together.
were talking about meeting people briefly, yeah.
And I know that James Hunter goes to Authors Nation, is what it is now.
Yeah.
Craig Martell, who runs the whole thing, we've taught together at a different writing conference, and he gave me this really gigantic, heavy silver coin. That is like an Alaska coin or whatever, because I think that's where he's from. And I still have it. I'm like, I don't know what this is for or its denomination. Like, I can't spend it, so I guess I'll just ooh.
Hey, paperweight, you never know what you need to clear a desk, you know.
It's
Put on a little
huge. It's
display
like
on the back
that
of it.
big. I'm like,
And yeah, it's almost the size you could put a display on. Of course, you know, bookshelves, books, like, I need more bookshelves. I have too many
yeah.
books. You never have too many books. That was bad on me.
You have too few bookshelves.
Bigger houses, you know, stuff like that.
Cool. That's my next goal. Bigger
Bigger
house for
houses.
books.
Have a whole room that is your personal library.
Yeah.
That'll be my next one.
But since I've worked with a lot of the people from 20 Books to 50K, which is rebranding as Author Nation?
Yes.
Okay, Author's Nation.
Yes. I'm paying attention to you. Yes.
Yeah, no, I've worked with a lot of the people there. So it's like, I still have access to those resources, but there's more resources that I don't have access to. So I want to go at least once, but I haven't gone before because they all show up at my house, basically. It's a writing conference here in Colorado, and they all show up, and I'm like, ah, good, don't have to go anywhere.
One of the cool things I know for me was the fact that I got to meet so many international authors as well. And so it's, you know, being near things like Dragon Con in Atlanta and big cities with that pool, some of these other authors is really neat because I get a lot of people stateside, but then meeting people all around the world was kind of phenomenal. I mean, like, wow.
Yeah, two of my book boxes went international because I met authors from other countries here on TikTok. And so one went to Australia and one went to Wales.
Oh,
Yeah.
I love it. And whenever someone can figure out how to send books at an affordable rate, please let me know, because that is one thing I'm still looking for.
Yeah, no, sending those boxes cost almost as much as the boxes, but I factored that into my math. So I was
Yeah.
planning ahead. I was like, we're good. It's fine.
Good. No, it is one of those things. Like, I do have some, and I, you know, it's amazing to have readers or wannabe readers who follow you and, you know, really like you, maybe even like your books if they have had the chance to read it, and then ask, they're like, can you send me a signed copy? And I'm like, I want to, but let's talk about logistics. It will be probably almost twice as much for the shipping as it is for my book. I know. I'm trying to be mean about it. It's the way it is.
My cover artist lives in the UK and he's like, I want one of the books. And I was like, oh,
No.
that might be a problem. So we're actually currently talking through the same thing right now where we're trying to figure out how to send the book for not $72.
No, I have one of my cover designers is in Ukraine and the other one's Croatia, and I'm like, yeah, that would be hard if they were asking for all the books a copy, and I was like, I can give you an ebook.
I do that a
You want the ebook?
You want
I'm
the
a
ebook? Here's the
physical
ebook.
print person, and I, you know, that's the way I love it, that it really is, and that's maybe detrimental to my space in my house. Again, the fact that I collect books and don't have enough space, but I like print. I paperback, hardcover, just give me the physical one, hold it.
Yeah, I'm a physical book person. I'm sure you can't tell. Well, you actually can't because you can't see the entire library. It's like a horseshoe of bookshelves that are all packed full. And I have to have the physical book. Ebooks just I'm tempted to get an ebook reader for the first time, but I'm not really looking forward to trying it. I'm like, my roommate's getting one, so I'm gonna try one book on his e-reader and buy the actual book later.
And I see a comment saying I love both print and ebook, and that is great because guess what? When you have ebook, you can travel with a library, which is an amazing idea because my suitcases are always really heavy because I travel
You can
with
travel with a library of physical books. You just have to be really dedicated.
Hey, our mutual friend, who's also on here for anybody, Marshall J. Moore, that's what he did. His wife gave him for Christmas a a
A
new
carry-on suitcase.
all the books that she was giving him for Christmas. And I was just like, well, that was brilliant.
Yeah.
Looking over, pretending my husband's listening, where's my bookcase of books, my suitcase of books?
I like Marshall's shopping sprees in general. I'm like, I need to sell a chunk of books at one time. That way I can do that. But I usually just acquire them one or two at a time, like Hansel and Gretel's crows picking up the breadcrumbs. I'm just like, oh.
Yeah, no, that's the thing is, like, and I have to, okay, for marketing, that's the thing. I'm always trying to get better at marketing. I will never claim that I'm the best at it because I am not. But the fact that I just started to do the open a few weeks prior to the holidays, where I temporarily closed and just reopened my bookshop so I can sell direct, is my one of my hopes of maybe I will one day make enough money so then I can buy a whole have a shopping spree myself, fund my own shopping spree.
Flamingo said, that's how I started with ebooks, is traveling for work and not wanting my suitcase to weigh as much as another.
Yeah, I definitely understand because I think that's one of the reasons why people love ebooks, and the same for audio is because a lot of people, especially the ones who drive for work, audio seems to be the way to go for them. And again, it's something that I love the idea. I've enjoyed the few books that I've had so far that have been turned to audio and listening during that process, but I always forget about it for myself.
Yeah, I've got a schedule where I've set aside time every day to read, 'cause I'm that kind of person
Love it.
where I schedule in my fun.
The way my life is, I no.
Yeah, but I've got scheduled time for reading, and my best friend gave me a physical TBR planner, like a book planner to write TBRs in and write which how much you read and reviews and stuff like that. So I've been doing even more physical reading this year already in a week than I did last year.
That's fantastic. Now, talking about reading, let's go back to your book. Okay, so your debut book came out almost a year ago, and you did the relaunch of the cover, not terribly long ago. So,
October.
give us the book blurb of your book. So we briefly mentioned you showed it beautifully, but tell us more for any of those who don't know anything about it.
All right, so this is the blurb for City of Day. City of Day, deadly by night. By day, Astera is a bustling port city with shops, shipyards, and people going about their day-to-day lives. But every night when the sun sets, the people of Astera board ships and abandon their home to the dark, murderous ghosts, the Vine. Thistlin lost his father to the vengeful spirits years ago and has barely survived on the streets as a common thief since. He dreams of escaping the dark truce of the island for good, but a family secret keeps him tied to the city and the oppressive ruling council. When he finds he is not the only one avoiding the entitled and sadistic gaze of Astera's nobility, Thistlin plans to help the gentle healer Mila leave everything behind to save them both, him from secrets and her from an unwanted marriage.
I love it.
However, Lord Soren Bastant, head of the ruling council and spurned suitor, won't let them go so easily. Caught and sentenced to a night on the island and the mercy of the Vine, Thistlin's only hope is to reveal his family's secret to save them or die. But Mila's family has a secret of its own, as does the ruling council. The Vine are not what they seem, and the fate of the kingdom hangs on the truth.
Don't. No, I love that. Ugh.
The dun 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 is implied, but you can feel it.
I can hear it in the back of my head. And that's one of those things is I wish I was better at blurb writing, and that was a beautiful pitch. It's so pretty.
I worked on writing my back cover copy with the help of one of my mentors, Jim Butcher. He told me to take my two-sentence pitch and then flesh it out. But the two-sentence pitch was the only part that really mattered, because that's what sells the book. Or that was what gets them to open the book, and then the book sells the book.
Yes, your turn.
yeah,
It's a
so
covered
my.
blurb slash pitch, and then that gets you to the first page of the chapter, that's the whole.
Yep.
That is the concept. And that is the flow for many people. And that made me ask a question recently, for the concept of these blind dates with the book. If you've ever, yes. So I was like, who likes this idea? Who doesn't? And I got about 50-50 because there were some people who were like, I'm sorry, I need to know what it's about, or, absolutely. And other people, it was interesting because some people were like, I don't know, maybe it would be really cool because I always judge a book by its cover, or, and maybe that would give me a reason to try things without, having that first impression based on the cover. It's just you get a mystery book. So have you ever done anything like that or read one?
Yeah, I've done two. Or no, I did three, and one of them was really cool. So one of the first books that I got in a blind date with a book is Fortuna Sworn, which is a dark romance, dark fairy romance, and it was like dark fantasy romance. And then on the front it had a Spotify scan, and it was like, if you like this song, you'll like this book, right? So that was a really cool one. I scanned the song, I listened to it, and was like, ooh, ooh, and bought the book. And then I did boyfriend material at a little bookstore in Montana. I got a little blind book that was queer romance, lighthearted, disaster boyfriends. And I was like, I'm in. I'm sold. And yeah, so those are my two favorite blind books that I've got.
I have a question. How do I get my book into something like that? Well, okay, so I don't know how you get it into physical places. Maybe you have an idea. For me, again, that's one of those things. If you want to do it for your books, I guess it's a little easier when you have multiple, so you have things to choose from. But I would definitely ask around because maybe a local bookstore would do it. There are authors. I've seen bookish people here send out bundles of them. So I think it's one of those things you ask around if you see it, inquire. for me, that's one of the things I was like, do I do it? Do I not do it for my books? Because I have a number of them now that I could offer, especially going forward, but I don't know. I'm in debate right now about my own work, but.
I'm like, I have one book. Blind date with a book. Guess which one?
But you never know. I mean, like you said, one of yours was a local bookstore, you said that you found one. So it may
Yeah.
be something like that, Stephen, that you can just go ask around and see what you can get your works into. And a lot of the local people are, I feel like, pretty open to talking with indie.
Yeah, one of my friends and followers is trying to get me into like a little local bookstore in their area that does do blind dates with books, so I've got my fingers crossed. But I'm just excited that people are trying to get my book into little shops. So I'm like, yeah. Put me on the
Yeah,
shelf.
you would help me spread the word. That's what I want.
Yeah, basically, that's what I want.
So for your book, where did this idea come from? Because everybody gets their ideas from 1,002 places or 1,000, but
So
where did it come from?
this is a brilliant story, actually. It comes from Sinbad and the Seven Seas. Like the actual book, the physical book. I have an antique copy of Sinbad, and I got really frustrated when somebody was like, oh, all book ideas are recycled from somewhere else. And I was like, you know what? Maybe they are. And I went and started reading other books to find inspiration. And it is one paragraph in Sinbad that inspired this entire book. Because Sinbad goes to a jungle island where all of the people have to sleep on their ships at night because gorillas come and will beat people up and like kill them. And I was like, well, that's really cool, except maybe not with gorillas. And
We'll do
so I
something
turned it
else.
into ghosts, and that's how City of Day was born, was because of Sinbad.
Oh, I love that. Honestly, I'm shocked to myself. I have not read the original Sinbad, though I do remember the claymation era movies of it because that was my jam. So I know vaguely some of the voyages, but I actually have not read it, so I don't think I know all the voyages of Sinbad. Huh.
There are so many that are just wild. Like they're weird, and I'm like, okay. There's like birds that eat people, so they tie sticks on their bodies so that the birds can't actually like swallow them. And I'm like, well, okay, that is definitely a story. There's no, Sinbad has some weird stuff in it.
Hey, a lot of the old stories, be it like ancient epics, all the way to the folklore and fable eras, some of them are kind of really logistically won't make sense to a modern reader, but they do make you chuckle.
They do. I actually have a book of memes from the late 1800s called The Book of Nonsense. And it's literally old school memes. Like there's little drawings with like horrible scientific names and little limericks and no, and it's the funniest thing ever because I'm like, I don't understand any of this, but it's great.
Absolutely great. Okay, wait, now I'm gonna have to write the Sinbad to put on my t future TBR when I get closer to reading some of these other. Yeah, I don't. I have like the unabridged, which is one I haven't gotten to, 1,001 Nights that I need to get to, which I've also heard kind of like that is wild tales. And obviously, you have the Aladdin, you have Ali Baba, and some of these more famed ones, but there are all the other stories too, which I'm like, what are they like? Because no one talks about that.
I have an illustrated copy from the 1930s that is gorgeous, and I've been afraid to read it because it's like it's in pristine shape. It's fine to read it, but I'm like I hesitate to read my antique books a lot of the time anyway. So
You need one of those special stands, no joke. Like they kind of, oh, I forgot, like they prop it up, but they have like wedges on the side. So the concept is the book doesn't lie 100% flat, so you don't break the back. Yes.
Yeah, I need to get one of those. And I need it on like a podium because I just want it to be inexplicably in the middle of rooms. Like I'm gonna move it from room to
Okay, a wheeled podium. A wheeled podium.
room.
That would probably be easier. Or
Perfect.
maybe strap it on like a Roomba if you have it and be like, me.
Yeah, let my podium wander about, follow it. That's how I get my exercise. I have a standing book podium.
Okay, that I feel like that's one of those gag things you tell to two different readers, and someone out there will buy into it and be like, that's what I need. That's all I need, guys. I will follow my podium. But yeah, no, actually reminded me, not the moving podium, but the old book. I'm gonna have that vision for a long time, a moving podium. But I live above Atlanta, and in and around where I live is this antique mall. Okay, cool, antique mall. One of the things that's fascinating about it has one of the country's, when I say ancient, like ancient bookstores in the middle of the mall. Like they have stuff that are over 1,000 and something years in the middle of this antique shop. And it's its own sub little category. And they go in and they like refurbish old books and they sell old books. And it is bizarre. And it's like, I go in, I'm like, I love this. I look at a price tag. I will never touch you. I love this. And then the owner's so sweet. He'll come up and he's always like, books are meant to be touched, but you must know how to pull one off properly from a shelf so you don't mess up the edging of the book, and how to properly read an old book. Again, not pulling it all the time. And he goes to the whole deal every time. He's like, go and play with all the books. Enjoy them. This is my English, Czechs, and French, you know, Italian, all this stuff. These are the ages. And I'm like, oh.
There's a couple of books that I'm looking for first editions of that will be like crowning jewels of my collection. And I love that I've got all of my nice books behind me and all of my antique ones are across the room and I'm like sitting here talking about them to them. But I am looking for a first edition Peter Pan and a first edition Christmas Carol. And those are the top two books that I want to have first editions of.
Ooh, very nice. For Christmas, my sister sent me a leather-bound Christmas Carol because there's a specific old black and white movie that my dad always watches Christmas Eve, and so she sent me a copy of it, kind of again nodding back to that tradition, and I was just like, me.
I got a beautiful, beautiful copy for Yalla Bakkaflod from a friend a couple years ago, and I was like, it's perfect. And it's so much shorter than I thought it was. I was like, I'm gonna sit down and read this, and it might take me a couple of days, and I finished it in one night and was like, oh, okay.
There you
Just like Scrooge, it took only one night.
Oh, goodness gracious. I wish I was a faster reader. It'd probably take me a couple, but no, that's, I am excited to try to actually read that one. I haven't read many Dickens, but A Christmas Carol, I feel like I should.
That one is really fast-paced compared to some of his other stories and easier to read, and the rhythm of it is fantastic. I don't know if you've seen the movie The Man Who Invented Christmas.
I have. It's been so long, well, I saw it right when it came out, so
Yeah.
long.
And I like that is now my headcanon for exactly how creating that book happened for him. I'm like, I know it's fictitious-ish. Like he still wrote that book in 6 weeks, which is crazy. He's like, it's October. I'm gonna make a book and sell it by Christmas. Ready, set, go.
There are people who do that. I wish. I am not one, but I wish I could like turn books quicker.
Yeah, so like the losing his mind aspect of it, I'm like, perfect. That is exactly what must have happened to this poor man.
There've been a couple, was it Finding Neverland? There have been a couple movies about the author's journey of creating it, and again, historical fiction history, you know, it's somewhere in there, but like it is kind of fascinating. You're like, huh, I wonder.
Yeah.
What would
Yeah.
your story be like? Huh, I wonder.
Mine would be really boring. I like sit at a desk and I type. That's it. That's the whole thing.
But you come up with the ideas, and you know, it's all about where your ideas come from, not necessarily the actual active process of writing.
Yeah. Let's just skip that part. Yeah,
Actually,
they
let's
mostly show
go
the
back.
writer's block.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
So coming up with ideas, so where do you get your character names? Because everybody seems to get them differently, and that's always a fun one for me to ask.
For City of Day, it was during a world building class when somebody was talking about naming conventions that I came up with some arbitrary little thing to throw in there. All male names end with N, and all female names end in a vowel.
That's not untrue.
it is very true. Yeah. So I was like, all right, I'm going to make it so that, you know, whenever I needed a guy's name to throw in there, I was like, what is a name that starts with, like, whatever, an N in an N? Ivan. Ivan is a name. Ivan. Like, so I was doing a lot of, like, names ending in N. Okay, that one. Thislin is plants for his name. Mila was actually a friend's character in a video game, and I was like, I'm taking that. Like, I cannibalize people's names. It's fun. For my dragon book, I've actually slightly altered names that I found in like 6 or 7 other dragon books, so that I can have that little nod back to all the other dragon books that I've been reading. And yeah, I get them all over the place.
Absolutely. So I already, you know, I know I'm going to be getting that one whenever it does come out, because I will collect all the dragons.
But so you're a dragon who hoards dragons?
Yes, I would hoard dragons if I can. I have sculptures of dragons in my office and anything. And that's why I weirded everybody out. The first series I had no dragons in it. And everybody who was my friend was like, I don't understand. And I was like, it doesn't have dragons. The other next two will have some, but that one, not so much. And everybody's like, I don't understand.
I have little dragons. I have two of them, but this one's my favorite. He's pretty.
Oh, I love it.
I love these little jointed dragons. They're so much fun.
That is so cool. And here comes my living dragon. My dog is a cone, because he recently got it. And you want to say hi?
Beautiful. Okay. Mine is actually behaving right now and taking a nap, and I'm very impressed. He's a puppy, so.
Well, technically, Odin's kind of a puppy. He just turned 2 on Tuesday.
Oh, so mine just turned 2 in December. So
you have a puppy friend. You don't even know it yet. Yes, Odin's a wolfhound, and I did not name him. He came with the name, surprisingly. No one believes that.
I named Mogwai, and it's a reference, because half my life is references. It's a reference to gremlins.
I love that.
Because a Mogwai is a gremlin before you put water on it or feed it after midnight.
I haven't seen the movie in forever, but now that you said that, I was like, yes. Yeah.
So I named him Mogwai, and then he's a purebred, and so he gets 2 names, because AKC registration has you have a call name, which is what you call them, mm-hmm. and a registered name, and so his registered name is Don't Feed After Midnight.
Oh my goodness. Well, Odin is a purebred, but he's rescue, so I only do rescues, and but he came with papers, and so I had to go through that process too, and I was not being very creative. I was being very straightforward, methodical. I was like, first name, our last name, and then afterwards, I was like, oh man, I missed the boat. I could have done anything wild and amazing, and I just was like very meh.
I work as, like, I work with a breeder as, like, her place for retiring dogs and for puppies, like Mogwai. Mogwai is a puppy, but he's got psychogenic polydipsia, so he wasn't widely adoptable. And I was like, all right, he's mine. Like, thank Aww. You. Yeah, so I take the old and damaged dogs.
That's sweet. Yeah. Sweet. I love it. And what kind is...
They are North Icelandic sheepdogs. Both of my dogs are. And it's a fascinating breed, like, story-wise, because they almost went extinct in the 70s. Mm-hmm. Like, there was less than 100 of these dogs left alive. Mm-hmm. And there was this big breeding program push, and that's why my breeder is a breeder of Icelandics, is because she was picked to be part of that program to, like, save the dogs. And, yeah. So it's like, fascinating. They've got extra toes. They have 22 toes.
Okay, that's how I know of that dog breed. Okay, that's where it comes from. I was trying to
play rocks.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, so they have way too many toes.
That is fascinating. That's really cool.
Yeah.
Okay, before I forget, because I just looked up. Hours move fast. Okay, so definitely I want to make sure I for sure hit some of the questions that I always want to make sure I cover, including where can people find and follow you outside of Book Talk? Because obviously here, do you have, as in, what other socials? Do you have a website and do you have a newsletter?
Yes, I do have a newsletter. You can sign up for that on my website at octoberksantarelli.com. And I also have an Instagram, which is O underscore K underscore writes, because somebody stole my TikTok handle on Insta. And yeah, my newsletter goes out bi-weekly and has some really cool stuff in it. My newsletter is getting, it's delicious. And I'm giving out a new freebie in my next one. So
Ooh,
I
that's
do
cool.
things.
And you said bi-weekly. I try to do one a month. Oh
Yeah, I send mine out every 2 weeks, and it's got like I'm designing new freebies for readers,
Love that.
specifically because I know that not everybody following me is an author. So I'm like,
Yes.
reader stuff. But I also try to design things that help authors as well. So the thing that's going out is a read and review spreadsheet,
Ooh.
which is it's like to track all of your reading, but it's also got checkboxes for the top three most common sites, Amazon, Goodreads, and Storygraph, so that you can just click on it and it'll take you to put your review up for the authors, and then you can check it off and it counts up how many reviews you've done and how many books you've read. And
That's cool. And okay, so Instagram, newsletter here, website. Now, where can people find and get your books as in buy them?
you can get signed copies directly from me. I have a couple of them listed in the TikTok shop as well. But on my website, there is a shop and you can get signed copies from me. I still have a couple of those book boxes we've been talking about. I'm running low, but I still have some. So if you want the little loot crate version, those are still there as well. You can get my books on Amazon and at Barnes and Noble. And if you've got local bookstores, little bookstores, they can also order it.
And that's one of the things is ex bookstores. If you have a local one, you can always go and ask for authors. India not, you can always ask if you're out there and just wanted to see. Same thing goes for libraries. I don't know if you've gotten your books in any libraries, but that's something that people don't realize is you can request it. And as long as an author is on the wide side, which it sounds like if you are in Barnes and Noble, you are, that's something that you could help get books from indie authors into places like that, which
You
I will
can
be,
read.
that's my intent to try to go wide this year. That's one of my 2024 goals.
I am actually in a library, and it's actually the only place you can read one of my books. I'm at the College Hill Library in Westminster here in Colorado, and that is the only place that has a copy of my YA sci-fi that has been out of print for over a year.
Wow.
So I only have two copies of it, and then the library has one, and those are the only copies I know that exist.
Wow. So, okay. So, when books get out of print, this is again the indie side of me that's trying to like wrap my head around this. Is that because you had a publishing deal and you printed a limited run and it's out, or are you able
Yes.
now to take that book and put it on an indie site and then redistribute?
This book is unique because with Storm's Eye, I wrote it with another author, David Brin.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, so David Brin is an old school sci-fi author. He's won awards and stuff like that, and he was reviving his 90s series in the 2020s. And so as he was reviving it, he was asking all his author friends for their apprentices. And I was thrown to the wolves and wrote up this book. And so it's both of ours. And since he's taken it out of print, but and it's his IP, I can't print it.
Fair, fair.
So that's why this one's out of print. It's the
I
only
got
reason.
you. That makes way more sense because I was trying to figure that out. I was like, I feel like there's a way, but that makes sense because co-authoring, that's a different animal. It's something I've never done before, but there is that you have to understand who owns the rights, do you equally, what happens if one wants to go one way, one wants to go another. So that is something I have not dabbled with yet, but that's
Luckily
still.
for this one, it's my book. I wrote the whole thing. He had primary edit to it, but all he really wanted us to do was write in his universe.
That's neat.
So he gets to put his name on it and gets a cut of it because he came up with the world, but I get my name on it and my cut of it because it's 100% my story.
That is fascinating. Well, you are connected with everybody, it sounds like, anyways, because I'm pretty sure you threw out names like Jim Butcher already early and like stuff like that. But that, again, that's great. It's like anybody, I don't know, you know, when you're beginning with, never hurts to ask. Or even if someone seems like they're out of reach, all authors are people.
Yeah, that's how
Interesting.
I ended up with the New York Times bestsellers that I have that are like, oh yeah, sure, I'll read your book. Oh yeah, sure, I'll throw you a blurb. Oh yeah, sure, I'll do that. I'm like, I just asked. Just walked up and was like, hey.
Thank you. Hi.
Hi. Hey. Hi.
Hi.
Not like that.
I'm gonna like laugh. Okay, wait, hold on. Breathe. Okay, so the third thing I always want to make sure I ask is, and this goes for anybody who's listening as well, is there any topic that you wanted to cover that we have not covered, or any question that you wanted to ask that you hadn't had a chance to ask yet? Because I always want to make sure everybody gets to cover the bases.
I'm like, put me on the spot, and of course my mind goes blank. It's gone.
Okay, how about
Nope.
this? Where's the next place that people can find you, a live event, or
A
even
live
on?
event. I will be a keynote speaker at a university event in March, at Front Range Community College. I will be a keynote speaker at a disability conference event thing. I will also be at Jordan Con in Atlanta in April with two new books. So hit me
Two.
up. Two new books. Oh, the cover. That's something that I wish I could. I'm like, oh, let me get my phone to show you guys the cover of the new book. Nope.
I understand. But no, that is so cool. I also have a double release in February. And the funny thing is, they're both in the same series, but at different stages. And the reason being is my Dark Viking Fantasy is novellas. So I release them only in ebook until I get sets of four. So I have the next new ebook, which would be volume 13, as well as the third omnibus releasing at the same time. So I'm gonna be like, if you like the series, now you can have the printed omnibus, or you can have new ebooks depending on where you are.
That's what my second printed book is. The Book of the Witch's Son is actually four novellas that follow a timeline leading up to another book.
I love that. Excuse me. Again, that cold that I'm almost over. Almost starting to catch up to me. But no, that's cool. I love novellas. And I feel like more and more people are appreciating them, which they're just fun to write. I don't know. I've enjoyed it.
I like them. I like that they're bite-sized. I like that it's something that you can get through in a day or two.
It is true. It is true. And that's the thing. They're quick reads. I mean, honestly, depending on how fast of a reader you are and the size of the novella, you could knock them out in a sitting.
Oh, yeah.
But yeah, so since my voice is getting to that scratchy point, and we have hit that hour mark, slash my dog's coming twice telling me it's about that time for him. You know. Anywho, thank you for coming out this afternoon, evening. I guess it's a little earlier for you, but thank you for coming out and hanging out with me, and I hope to see you in face to face in DragonCon, and we'll be talking about other things before then, I'm sure.
Perfect. That sounds fantastic. And yeah, thanks for having me on. It was super fun.
And I do these weekly, so if you want to do this after your double launch, we can always come back and talk about how you survived that.
Please, let's do it. Let's plan on it. That sounds
Perfect.
perfect.
And thank you for everybody who's been listening. Have a wonderful night, and I will catch you all next time. Bye.
Bye.